Okay. Welcome, everybody. We've had our first bit of COVID shenanigans already. I'd really like to welcome all of you who've come here in person, and also those online. I hope that you managed to get the updated link and that you can hear me. This service or gathering is at Saxby's Cider Tap Room in Farndish. We're here to say farewell to my father, John Saxby. Now, the lockdown's made things a bit different. In the ideal world, I think he would have liked to have been have a service in, say, somewhere like Poddington. He liked visiting old churches in his older age to belt out a few traditional hymns. And then off to the golf club, where I think it would have been our sacred duty to have a few beers and sing some songs. And above all, everyone would have been invited. Of course, we all know things are different, and nevertheless, we can still celebrate. And what better alternative venue than a cider room in one of his old pig barns on the farm that he used to own and run. So we're going to play some hymns out loud, and even though you're not allowed to sing, maybe you can hum along and participate. And we're going to do the best we can. Just a few words of how it's all structured. We've got this service, and then afterwards, just a few friends and close family are going to the crematorium. Philip has set up a spoof competition for those staying behind. There's a crate of cider on offer for the winner when we get back from the crematorium. I'm looking for the older generation to teach the younger generation how spoof works, and look forward to finding out who the winner will be. There's a bit in the middle of this service. You'll notice in your service sheets you've got a green sheet and you were given a pen. I'll explain a bit more, but at the middle of the service, during a time of reflection, we thought it would be nice for people to have an opportunity to write some thoughts or blessings, which Iris is then going to come around and collect up in a basket. We're going to take that basket with us to the crematorium. It will be put with Dad and the coffin, and so that can be kind of a way of saying a personal farewell to him. I'll talk more about that when we get there. Okay, so if we kick off with the formal part of the service, and if you would like to just bow your heads to say, I'll say an opening prayer. Dear Lord, thank you that you made us in your image and for giving us gifts and talents to serve you and one another. We thank you for John Saxby's life, for all that he was, and for all the years we shared with him. We lift him up to you today in our thoughts and prayers and memories, and ask that you bless this time of grief and joy. Be with us as we celebrate and remember his life, and help us to give him a jolly good send-off. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. So would you like to stand for our first hymn, Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer?
Thank you.
Isabel's now going to come and read, do the reading for us.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside calm waters. He leads me on level paths. For his name's sake, he restores my soul. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
So we've now got a time of, I put tributes with S in it, and Phil's going to say a few words first, and then David Pratt's also going to say some words.
Well, first of all, hello, and thank you all very much for coming today. As William pointed out a few moments ago, this is definitely not the sort of service we would have wanted, and definitely not the sort of service that Dad, John Saxby, would have wanted. As William said, he would have wanted a service with lots of people, lots of laughter, people exchanging stories, most probably up at Wellingborough Golf Club and having a jolly nice afternoon. But it's not to be, and we are here. So falls to me to just say a few words about Dad. Dad, basically, facts of his life, born in Wellingborough, the youngest of three. Now, I'm told that my grandfather was so happy to have a boy, I don't know whether Jean can back me up, whether this is just a rumour or not, so happy to have a boy that he put a flag up at Linden's in Midland Road to let Wellingborough know that a boy had been born. Is this true or not? I don't know.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is, yes. Okay.
So, it's
in the
newspaper.
It is. Is it? Oh, it's right there. Okay. Do your research next time. Born in Linden's, the flag going up, educated at Wellingborough, then Aldenham, spent a little bit of time National Service, then went on to work down the factory, where he met a lot of lifelong friends and contacts throughout. And at some point he decided that he fancied a little bit more than he fancied basically the country life more. So he came out here, started running the farm with my mother, Zandra, and basically that's where I come in. So, looking at Dad and his personality, and I think it's been covered in so many of the cards and so many of the things that have come in, the thing that comes across time and time again is what a outgoing personality was, how much he loved. He had a knack, really, of just really getting on with all sorts of people. In fact, one thing I noticed was he always seemed to find his way to where all the fun was to be had in a room, as opposed to where, you know, high society might be. He was like always at the end where a game was going on or a song was going on, a rugby song or a game of spoof, as I previously mentioned, spoof. Now, you will all know, because he will definitely have told you, he certainly told us, that he was an international spoofing champion. Spoofed all over the world, apparently, and didn't have any trophies to show for it or anything like that, but he did. He loved spoof, played it a lot, He had a childish sort of joy whenever he got the number right, which, you know, was only occasionally. But he used to go skipping out of the room whenever he got the number right. But as a child looking at him, knowing all what a great spoofing player he was, I couldn't really understand why he was quite so often up at the bar buying the drinks at the end of every game. But, hey, who knows? His other great passion in life was golf, a passion that he's passed on to me and William with varying degrees of success. But he was definitely, joking apart, he was a good sportsman, and he was definitely a very good golfer as well. He won the Wellingborough Golf Club Championship a number of times. He won the County Championship. And I think what really helped him in playing was that sort of relaxed attitude that he had. I can honestly say, in all the rounds that we played with him, we had a lot of great times and rounds together, that I don't think I saw him lose his rag once. And I asked him quite recently, because I was interested to know, when you won the County Championship, what was your preparation? Expecting some almost marvellous formula that brought him together at his perfect peak of physical and mental condition at the moment that he got onto the first tee. He said, well, he had a think, and he said, well, I went out the night before, and then I had a really long early shift at the factory. So one thing ran into another, and I managed to jumped in my car, and I nearly missed the first tee. So that kind of summed it up. You know, instead of, you know, worrying about it for ages and ages, he just jumped in and let it happen. And and that's something I kind of, I have to admit, I've always envied, really, that ability just to kind of allow it to happen. From a children, her son's point of view, Dad, I think we'll all agree, was not, I don't want this to come out the wrong way, he wasn't a supportive father as such. Not in the sense of, you know, constantly bigging us up and all the rest of it. I think that basically, underneath it all, he believed in us, he wanted us to do well, but he could never quite articulate this. What I remember most was, in fact, here's a little story, actually, from when I was, this kind of exemplifies it, really. I was best man at Tim Poole's wedding. I'd done a great speech. People were patting me on the back. They were asking for encores. I was feeling great. I came down, had a drink. Everybody, you know, it kept going. Quiet moment at the bar. My dad sidled up to me. I said, I did all right, didn't I? He went, yeah. Enjoy the moment, because tomorrow you'll be a nobody sitting on a tractor. Now, I don't bear any malice. It makes me laugh. I think it's really funny. Because I think at its core, as I said, he wanted us to do well and he believed in us, but he didn't really want us to become big-headed, which I don't think we have, so thanks, Dad. Appreciate that. And I've mentioned that he was a very easygoing chap, but he also had various, like all of us, I guess, maybe, a lot of very stringent life rules, some things that you were sort of no-go areas unless you wanted to have a particular argument. Some of his things were such as seatbelts. Hated seatbelts because, as far as he was concerned, he didn't want to be told by the man what to do, and it was symptomatic of the nanny state, as far as he was concerned. So he never wore a seatbelt. In fact, later in life, he had a little metal plug that he'd plug in to stop the cars beeping at him when he drove along, which made him feel a lot better. So the seat belts, drink driving. He had a fairly liberal view about drink driving. I know these days it's kind of frowned upon. But again, I think for the same reasons before, he didn't like to be told what to do. And as far as he was concerned, he was a better driver after he'd had a few drinks. And woe betide anybody who tried to take the keys off him. And I'm looking around the room and I know a few people who have over the years who tried to take the keys off him when he felt that he was good enough to drive home. So there was that. There was beards. He hates beards. He hated beards as well. Thought it made men look untidy. What else did he have? Never indicated at roundabout because. Yes, because people should know. Now let me remember this. People should know which way I'm going by my position on the road. So the idea of doing that, or that was just too much. So. Any music after 1949, just a noise. So there was a few of the rules, but that's what part of the foibles and idiosyncrasies that make us all up. And I think he will be sorely missed by everybody in this room, certainly by all of us as a family. And I think if I can sum up John Saxby, my dad, in a sentence, I would say, it was he tried to live life to the full, but he had the good sense not to take it or himself too seriously. So, Dad, I love you very much. Thank you.
David.
Thank you, Phil. When Philip suggested that I have a few words about growing up with John, I thought, God, that's going to be difficult. 72 years we've known each other, and I'll have to make it pretty brief to cram it all in. But then I realised that he'd said growing up. And so I could then eliminate the last 54 years, because we were married in 1966, and by then we were grown up, because we were told we had to be, so by our wives. We met at Wellingborough School. It wasn't especially eventful time. John was, a year ahead of me, but we developed a close friendship. He was a very good footballer, and I was in the football team as well. And so we had that in common. I don't think he was a cricketer. I'm not sure. He played cricket after school, but I'm not sure he figured much at school, Wellingborough School. And So we grew up at Wellingborough. He eventually, Philip had said, he went off to Aldenham later for the senior school. I stayed at Wellingborough. And Wellingborough was generally, mainly, as far as we were concerned, we used to get together in the holidays and play and go to the factory, which was a wondrous place, the factory, because the factory was where there were rats and dens and rubbish and things that we could do. We could shoot starlings, and moreover, we could eat pies. That was absolutely fantastic. John, as far as I was concerned, we didn't eat enough pies while we were at the factory, because John, we only went occasionally down to the factory, and he always had a pasty, and I always went for steak and kidney pie. But the other thing, advantage of the factory, was that we used to do quite a lot of fishing together. And so to save us having to make up sandwiches before we went, we'd go down to the marvellous factory sandwich department and buy wrapped up sandwiches in white bread, all soft and lovely with cheese or ham and tomato and things in like that. And they were absolutely fantastic. So the other thing we did at the factory was that we decided we wanted to make a boat. I don't know why, but I was always fairly good with my hands. John really wasn't very good with his hands. but we decided we should make a boat. And we did it in the factory. Where we got the materials from, I cannot think. So we made this construction, which was a bit like a sort of sentry box with a pointed prow. And to make it waterproof, we got hold of some boiled tar, which we painted all over it. Goodness knows where we got this from. So we painted this stuff on. And finally, we took it down to the river. And the river doesn't, this bit of the river doesn't really exist now. It's just near Tesco. And the river, the mill race from, I think they call it Turnell's Mill. And the mill is still there, the rusty mill wheel. It's still, you can see as you come off the A45 just by the roundabout. But this wound round and rejoined the river just near the bridge. And we finally launched this boat, and it wasn't very satisfactory. I think we built it too tall, and so it wasn't stable. I think it leaked as well. I think we had the odd trip up and down this little jitty. But finally, we got fed up with it, so we burnt it. We burnt it on the side of the river. We'd got permission to moor it there by, I think, Mr. Saxby, who knew quite a lot of people in that area. I can't remember who it was, but there was other people that he knew there. So we burnt the boat. A little later on, we decided to make another one, and this was much more successful. And this time, we made it in my house at Debdale Road. And in this occasion, we made it with a new wonder material, which was called hardboard, and it came from Sweden. And we made this, it's about that high, and about 6 foot long, with a pointed, we couldn't do any curves or shape it, so we made right angle prow, and made it waterproof with something called sealastic, painted it with grey paint, and this time it worked really well. So we used to paddle up and down the river, up towards Northampton in one direction, and down towards where Pam used to live, Chester House. And on one occasion, it was entirely manual at this stage. And then on another occasion, John, we used to wear these capes, these yellow capes that on our bikes to cycle to school in. And John stood up with his cape like this, and found that it blew us along the river. So John became the sail for the time being. So after that, we put a mast on it and duly used it as a yacht. Now, during the holidays, we'd work at the factory as well. We used to work in the factory as well. We'd work in the Christmas holidays and fill the pies with jelly and things like that. And it was great. It was quite good fun. Our first holiday together. When I ever think of John, it's always sort of rats and the factory. And the other thing was smoking, of course, at the factory. Now smoking was a big deal. At the factory, we made a den from which we used to shoot at things. And John always had an everlasting supply of cigarettes. And at one stage, he bought a 50 cigarette pack from his house, from his father. Goodness knows why his father didn't recognise that he'd gone. He was also good for a few cigars. So we used to sit and smoke and shoot things out of this den. And so that. So the time passed in a very satisfactory way. The first holiday we had together was, and William knows all about this, it was at Greatwood Camp. Now, I can't remember whether this was at when we were just before senior school or just before. Would it be about age of 12? Because William knows all about it. Because
I know where Greatwood is.
Greatwood Camp was in Somerset, in the Quantock Hills.
Yeah, probably 12.
A marvellous place. It was in a clearing in the pine forest, with a stream running through it, and round the side of the clearing were about a dozen log cabins, and we slept six, I think, or so in a log cabin. And it was real adventure, because we were on our own, we've got no parents or anything like that to oversee us. And it was run on slightly religious grounds, because that always went against the grain a little bit, because we liked going out and going for stag hunts or night manoeuvres in the forest. But John always used to, I'll never forget this, we had a song that they used to sing. It went something like, "Hello, hello, pray welcome be, to feel quite free, to breathe this rare unrationed air, to climb the trees just as you please." And then it went rambling on. But John always stopped there. He'd say, "And be sure you're back for prayers." That was his great thing. So that was the first holiday we had together. After that, we had holidays with his Aldenham friends. And he gained a lot of friends from Aldenham. And he brought them back to our area. And we had a few holidays with them on the Broads and various other places. Together we had some memorable holidays where we drove across the continent, one to the south of France, and travelling around. We never used to book any accommodation. I can't remember, I can't think how we did it. But I know at one time, I've got a photograph of it, and I really wanted to give you a copy of the photograph so you could blow it up. We're lying on a haystack in the middle of the south of France somewhere, and I remember clearly rats running across us in the night. But but an even more memorable one was when John and I took my TR3 to Austria, Austria, Germany. And on this occasion, we went to Salzburg and various places. John had been skiing, I think, a year or two before that, and he was aware of the area around Kitzbühel and Seefeld and Wengen. So we sort of retraced his steps there. And we ended up going to, I think, Innsbruck. They're all sort of close-ish to each other, Wengen and Kleiner Scheidegg and things like that. And I remember clearly on one occasion we were, I think, at Wengen or Kleiner Scheidegg, and we went up into the Eiger. The Eiger, this enormous face of the Eiger, where people climb, obviously. And I remember him saying that on one of his holidays, he'd been at this resort. I think it was Wengen, and they looked across the valley, and there was a man hanging on a rope, dead, on this sheer face. And the Eiger is a horrendous face to climb. And this man had fallen with two other climbers. His name was Tony Kurtz, I seem to remember. And the other two climbers had died, and this man had just hung there, and he'd frozen. And the awful part about it was that there's a window in the Eiger. The railway goes up from Wengen through the Eiger and winds around and goes onto the top to the Jungfrau. And the window was literally a few feet below this hanging man. So it was a pretty grim thing. So we went up on the railway, and we got to the top. And as I say, John had done a bit of skiing. I hadn't. And so at the top, we were able to hire some skis for half an hour or something, and we did a bit of skiing. And I was completely useless, twisted my knee, because I thought to turn on a ski, you turned, which of course you don't. So that was part of that holiday. It must have been quite a long holiday because, as I say, we went to so many places. The final place was the climax of it. Though we went to a little place called Cochem on the river, I think it was the Moselle. I think it's more or less where the Moselle joins the Rhine. And there we ran into what I think was the last remnants of General Patton's American Rhine forces. This was in about, I suppose, 1954 or something like that. And we met this chap called Al, and he took us in, and we went back to their mess. And we had the most riotous night, drinking American beer and eating an enormous amount of food. I remember showing off and eating two steaks and feeling lousy after it. And it was a very successful evening, but we felt a bit rough at the end of it. After our various holidays, a fair few years then passed after that, and one of the other things we were involved in was the Gastronomical Society. Now, both John at that time had sort of ideas of being a bit of a chef. I don't think he sort of carried that on, but at that time he was quite interested in a bit of cooking, and a couple of other friends were as well. So we started what we called the Wellingborough Gastronomical Society, but prior to that, we entertained each other in each other's homes. So two of us would cook for the four, a group of four. And we did that a couple of times. And then we thought, well, it's quite a nice idea if we got a little group together and visit pubs or restaurants, because eating out then wasn't like it is now, where you can get good food in dozens of places. The good of eating was pretty few and far between. So we then decided to call ourselves the Wellingborough Gastronomical Society. And that meant we would approach a restaurant in advance and say, the Gastronomical Society are going to grace you with our presence. What can you do for us? One or two people said, sod off, we're not going to do anything for you. But on a number of occasions, they would do something special for us. And I remember one of the very first ones was in 1962 or 3. It was the night of Kennedy's assassination, because one always remembers that. And this was at the Three Swans at Market Harbour. And I remember they put on Moo Marinier, which was a very, very elaborate thing at the time. So that was that. And we had a number of very good meetings over, I suppose, about... It straddled our the dates that when we were married. In other words, it's probably from about 1960, what, to 1968, something like that. And we had a lot of memorable evenings, several of which were worth mentioning. There was the, as I say, the Market Harbour one, and then there was the Three Swans. Then there was the Hollow Tree at Stoke Goldington. Now, that's no longer exists, but that's out near on the Northampton Bedford Road. And I remember going there, and it was a terribly cold, misty, foggy night. And we, on the way back, John insisted on sitting on the bonnet of my car. So we couldn't see where we were going. John sat on the bonnet, and at one point we had to stop, and John flew off the car. And when he got off, he was covered in frost. His eyes and his hair were all white. And the final one was, and this really put an end to the Gastronomical Society, was at Overstone Solarium. One of our members, his cousin, ran the solarium. And we went over in advance, and I think he was arranged to put on rack of lamb and pate, and these were quite elaborate things at that time, and Gewürztraminer, which we'd never drunk before. And so off we went. By that time, we had called it the Wellingborough Gastronomical Society, but we then crept in the name Bacchanalian, and that was a mistake, because at this point it was getting too Bacchanalian. A lot of people came along for the Bacchanalian rather than the Gastronomical. So anyway, we arrived at Overstone, and most of us arrived, and we suddenly realised Roland Thomas hadn't arrived, and he lives in Daventry. So we had a few more pints, and another glass of wine, a bottle of wine, and still no Roland. So we rang him. Oh, he said, I've forgotten. I'll be with you as soon as I can. Off he came. Meanwhile, we're still knocking back the wine. Eventually, Roland turned up. We have our meal, very good meal, very rich meal. And we'd had more than enough to drink. And I remember talking about spoof. John insisted on spoofing for bottles of port. And he lost every time. So at the end of this evening, John had bought about four bottles of port and lost each time, and we were all a bit the worse for wear. That signaled the end of the Gastronomical Society. I think we might have had one more meeting after that. But it was really, by that time, we were married. I think it was about 1967 or 1968. And we thought it had run its course. Have I got time to wait?
Okay. Thank you very much, David.
I was going to mention the Royal Society.
I was wondering if you were going to public speak as long as you did.
I was going to say
talking.
The last time.
And
I
you do.
John was the half moon at Grendon, which was on the 12th of March, just before the problems with this COVID. And we met at I took him over, and he was on his Zimmer. Found it difficult to get up the gravelly path, grumbled like hell about the safety belt, putting the seatbelts on again, grumbled about pushing up to the door. And but we did have a drink with John Merry, who was his big pal, and that was the last time we went out, and that was about it. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I was actually really—I wasn't sure, David, whether you were going to say some words, but it's really, really good to get the perspective of his youth, because I don't really have much more to add to what Phil said. I think I just endorse everything that Phil said. I also just wanted to thank everybody that wrote letters and cards of condolences, and it's been so nice to read through them. The common themes have come out that you've heard. It was fun. He lived life to the full. He was kind. He was always up for a party and didn't need an excuse to start singing. Somebody else, I first met John singing Alouette in a bar in Ireland. He lived by his own rules. Lively, enthusiastic, engaging. Very good company. I don't think we want to also neglect his civic duties. He was a councillor for a while, a county councillor on the parish council here. And I think, as Phil pointed out, he could be pretty curmudgeonly. I think towards his grandchildren, he was a bit Victorian, seen and not heard. But a friend of ours came to visit and she said, when I came to visits to Farndish, we're always very enjoyable amidst the chaos, the animals and the children. But some things could be relied on. John reading the paper, John not being happy about something. The dogs in front of the Argo, John not liking the noise. But she said, but beneath it all, delighted to be surrounded by his family. And I think that's, again, what Phil said, Dad didn't speak his love, but you knew it. He never articulated it in words, and he wasn't particularly tactile either, but we all knew he cared. His love was one of presence. He was gregarious, he needed people with him, and he wanted to be face-to-face and unmasked, and I think he would have hated this masking social distancing time, and I'm pleased he hasn't really had to bear it. At base, there was kindness, and I've been so blessed to have a father who was there for me and proud of me, and at the very end, even in his dying frailty, he still had a cheeky twinkle in his eye. So thank you for everybody. I'm going to hand you over to Claire, who's going to read a poem.
I'm going to read two poems by Christina Rossetti. Everyone else has held it together very well. I might cry, but I feel that that's sort of in keeping with Dad. Towards the end of his life, he used to cry a lot. If he'd come round to my house, which he did regularly on a Sunday evening, I'd say, oh, the children are pleased to see you. Oh, are they? Are they glad? And it was anything like that all the time. So I feel that that's, reasonably respectful. When I come to the end of the road and the sun has set for me, I want no rights in a gloom-filled room. Why cry for a soul set free? Miss me a little, but not for long, and not with your head bowed low. Remember the love that once we shared. Miss me. But let me go. I knew that would be the bit that got me. For this is a journey we all must take, and each must go alone. It's all part of the master plan, a step on the road to home. When you are lonely and sick at heart, go the friends we know. Laugh at all the things we used to do. Miss me, but let me go. When I am dead, my dearest, sing no sad songs for me. Plant though now no roses at my head, nor shady cypress tree. Be the green grass above me with showers and dewdrops wet, and if thou wilt remember, and if thou wilt forget. I shall not see the shadows, I shall not fear the rain, I shall not hear the nightingale sing on as if in pain. And dreaming through the twilight that doth not rise nor set, haply I may remember, and haply may forget. I think I chose these poems partly because towards the end of his life, Dad was really quite unwell, and why I say the beginning part gets me is because he really was set free. Mum had done a brilliant job of trying for so long to keep him well and at home, and unfortunately, in the end, possibly David's speech gives us an idea of why she couldn't. There were some errors made earlier in life, possibly. But also because at the end, I think that word haply, it perfectly describes his life. He was... like that, he just bounced through and he got on with things. So that's why I chose those.
Okay, we now come to the... We're going to just have a time listening to a piece of music that Dad used to like. And this is where the green bits of paper and the pens come in. If you would like to write or draw, or whatever, say something to Dad, when the hymn is said, Iris is going to come around and collect up those notes, and we'll take them with us to the crematorium on your behalf. It's kind of an idea. There's a guy, John Dunn, wrote was meditation, really, and he said, all mankind is of one author and is one volume. When one man dies, one chapter is not torn out of the book, but translated into a better language. And every chapter must be so translated. And God's hand is in every translation. And his hand shall bind up our scattered leaves again for that library where every book shall lie open one to another, where every book shall lie open one to another. So please write on your leaves and we will scatter them and gather them up for your... Okay, hold on, just... hang on. Okay, would you like to stand for the final hymn and then we'll collect up the your messages during this hymn. Okay, hit it.
Yes.
you. Okay, we come to the final part of the service. Would you just like to bow your heads? I'd like to say a final blessing. And a final prayer. In the name of our Father in heaven, we ask that you take up all that has been said and thought today and bless the life and memory of John Saxby for all that he was to us, husband, father, brother, grandpa, uncle, neighbor, friend. We ask that you take up these leaves and bind him into your eternal book. His last chapter here is finished. His last candle has been snuffed out, leaving us only the smoke of some fine memories. And we will weep because he is no more. And we will grieve for his loss. But above all, we give thanks. We give you thanks that he was. Above all, we give you thanks that he was. Amen. So we are now going to head off to the crematorium. If you're staying behind, please have some refreshments, play some spoof, and we will see you back here in about 40 minutes or so. Thank you.